That's when I knew that I could finally say, 24-7. These are the words of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the remaining elders among the exiles, and to the priests, the prophets, and the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had taken into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles to whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage. That they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For its welfare you will find, in its welfare you will find your welfare. A sense of peace.
Second reading this morning comes from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 15. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David. That is my gospel for which I suffer hardship, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But the word of God is not chained. Therefore I endure everything for the sake of the elect, so that they may also obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is sure, if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, we will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind them of this and warn them before God that they are to avoid wrangling over words, which does no good, but only ruins those who are listening. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by God, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
God be the glory. During our celebration in mind, celebrating 65 years of history of this church in which we stand, in which we sit, to God be the glory for every minute and every day. For the people that weren't here last year, last Sunday, we usually start the sermon with a little humorous joke, right?
Very well.
Sometimes. And last week we heard about Lawrence Welk and his wife, who love the name Anna, so they named their daughters, the three daughters, Anna 1, Anna 2, Anna 3. So, and that seemed to be a big hit. Well, at least last Sunday. This week we had our annual conference in Orlando. All the UCCs, United Church Christ Churches throughout the state of Florida, 84 churches, our family from 84 different faith communities coming together for our annual meeting. It was wonderful. All the way back from the 3-hour drive from Orlando, you know, I get sleepy and I was driving alone. So every time there's one of those rest areas where you can stop and have, you know, Kentucky Fried Chicken or Taco Bell or whatever, I stopped and got a soda and just, you know, to try to stay awake. So I walked into the gift shop of one of the places. And they have little turnstiles and have little books, inspirational books. You know, I thought, oh, how wonderful. I'll just take a look at a few of these. And there was one I ended up having just to purchase. It's called 1 Minute Devotions, Grace for Today. Because in this 1 Minute Devotion, there's a devotion for each day of the year for 365 1 Minute Devotions. So I said, let me look and see what Sunday's going to be. October the 13th. What will it say? And God spoke through this little book, especially to the choir. Gratitude glorifies God. I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonders, Psalm 91. And it says, though, even though religion is a serious matter, some of God's most dedicated servants have been lively, happy people. A faith that is void of humor can hardly express the spirit and attitude of Jesus Christ. See? They like my humor. One of the most beautiful things we read about Jesus is that ordinary people enjoyed listening to him, and children were at ease in his presence. This would not have been true had he been constantly gloomy. He emanated a deep peace and happiness. Joy and quiet humor enabled him to love and appreciate people. Your sense of humor, enriched by your gratitude and love, is a gift from God. Thank you for that wisdom. Just so happened to be for today. It's important to have a sense of humor. I don't know how we can survive without that. The readings today, the first one comes from the prophet Jeremiah. And Jeremiah shares with us something very important. I love the part of the passage where he says, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. So in that city, in its welfare, you will find your welfare. And it reminds me of the history of our church. If I can find it. We're celebrating 65 years of history. And I want to share with you some of the welfare that has come along in the last 65 years. It hasn't been easy. There's been heights and there's been lows and there's been journeys in between. The Reverend Arthur Snow with his wife Alice came to Fort Lauderdale in May of 1954. And he was the first time minister of this, what they called in the Mission Church. Arthur and his wife were welcomed May 16, 1954. And at the worship service that day, the congregation voted to change the name of this church to First Congregational Church with a community church added as a subtitle. They wanted to be known as a community church. They had a vision from God. At the foundation service on October 1954, Reverend Tuttle received into membership 115 charter members at that time. Wonderful. In 1954, in November, they actually purchased a parsonage for the pastor at 2701 Northeast 29th Court, very close to here. A parsonage for the pastor. And actually, the other day, I walked up to the door and knocked on it and said, "You're living in my house." It says right here, this is a parsonage for the church. And they just slammed the door. I think I scared them. At the time, the Florida Conference, of which we're a part of throughout the state of Florida, they gave $250 to this church to buy equipment. What a great gift. But the members, those 150 members, got together. And it says that there were seven lots around that parsonage. Empty lots, land on which this place stands. So the people got together and it says that flyers were sent out, each with a tiny bag of earth attached. I imagine them coming over with a little shovel, like you go to the beach with, and putting dirt in all these bags that go along with all these flyers, and walking around the neighborhood and giving these flyers to the neighbors. Can you imagine when you open your mailbox and go, "What in the world is this? A bag of dirt." It says, "We now see parcels of earth, a site where we may build a lovely church," on the flyer. So the architects got together and their promotion works. And the architects were engaged to construct a contemporary type structure at that time, to include classrooms, nursery, kitchen, and a hall that would fill 256 people capacity. They had the groundbreaking ceremony in March of 1956, and they lifted the first dirt. A little girl did with her tiny little beach shovel, broke the ground. Can you imagine that? The people gathered around, the little girl breaking the dirt. Some of the 146 people attending, there were so many people, they had to sit on sawhorses. No children's stools or stand in the rear because there were only 125 chairs at the time for people to sit. And at that time, the words "a friendly church in the heart of Coral Ridge," it says, were added to the advertising. A community church. 250 old hymn books were on loan from our Florida conference. Can you believe it? They loaned us 250 old hymn books. It was wonderful. For Sunday use. In spite of many frustrations and growing pains, Arthur Snow was able to guide the church through the construction. I can't even imagine what that would be like. And it served as the sanctuary over there for 7 years before he arrived. Then they had the next pastor come along. Second full-time minister, Reverend Wesley Rydell, who preached his first sermon on October 19, 1958. He was a graduate of Yale University, very educated. But May of 1961 represents a milestone in the history of this church. On that day, the congregation voted unanimously to unite with the United Church of Christ. At 10:30 a.m. on March 25, 1962, the cornerstone of the new sanctuary out there was laid with Curtis Millen presiding as the master of ceremonies. Barbara, would you raise your hand? Her husband? Yes. How come they left her name out? We'll go back and revise this. Because she's still here and serves this church every day. Then we have Reverend Rydell, who served as a minister until November 1966. Before the conference sent the Reverend Melvin Dollar, minister of church extension, to organize a church in the Tamarack area. In Tamarack, this church was doing so well, they wanted to expand, and they asked this church to help in that expansion, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ through this community and beyond. This church lent them folding chairs and benches, and they sent members to attend church services and fellowship dinners, and they provided a secretary to serve until the regular offices were elected. Hoping I wouldn't let anybody borrow by me that many times. So they were very generous back then. The next minister to lead was Harold Stephens. He came in February 1967. Stephens. Now part of his is the Social Action Committee responding to the council said, this committee feels very strongly that it's important for our church to try to lead the way in overcoming prejudice. The call. To try to lead the way in overcoming prejudice. So they had an exchange of pulpits was arranged in June of 1970 between this church and the First Baptist Church, exchanging pastors and to be able to speak and get to know each other. Several members of each church attended the other church. And just about a year or two ago, how the class of 3000, because our lot is so full and there's not enough parking space, they allow our members to park over there for the overflow parking. Back then in 1972, the Coral Ridge National Bank provided additional parking spaces for this church. It's always had that problem. Many months were devoted to studying and planning the remodeling of the kitchen table after that. The Women's Fellowship had been saving money for this project to remodel the kitchen, our commercial kitchen, which feeds, right now prepares over 8,000 meals a year. The Women's Fellowship had been saving money for this project and had pledged $3,000 a year, but it soon became evident that more was needed to acquire the $41,000 needed for construction and $12,000 needed for equipment. The trustees of the church were sympathetic and realized that the new facility would be used by everyone, and they suggested to the council that the church assume the debt and believe the women of their pledge. During the years of Harold Stephens' pastorage, the membership had its period of greatest growth, reaching a total of 961 people. In 1977, the subtitle, A Friendly Church in the Heart of Coral Ridge, was dropped from the advertising. Kirby Smith's associates were again hired to conduct a growth campaign, which started in November of 1979. And this complete survey census succeeded in finding out the talents and the abilities of the members in placing the church in a strong financial position because they needed to secure repairs and maintenance for these buildings. We're reliving that. It's amazing the history of these last 65 years. In this book, you can receive a copy, check out from Bonnie in August if you'd like to read it. I suggest you do so. And I love the part of the history of this church which talks about music. Yes, music. With the voice of singing, declare ye this and let it be heard. These words of an old anthem describe the place that music has had in the life of the First Congregational Church. The choir has been involved in the growth of the church through its regular participation in the Sunday worship, through its presentation of Christmas and Easter cantatas, and through the sponsorship of many enjoyable evenings of entertainment. To finance the purchase of music and equipment, the choir presented many fine programs, which they still do. In 1960, the choir appeared for the first time in new white nylon robes. Aren't you grateful? Because it says the heavy maroon robes, too hot for Florida, were both a gift of G.H. Martin. And we know the Martin family very well. There was Women's Fellowship. As soon as the handful of people decided in June of 53 to form a mission church, 10 women met at the home of Marge Hall, we're told, to organize a women's guild. The first meeting was held at the home of Helen Burnett, and at the panel discussion, I Have a Secret. 5 years until the fellowship hall was finished. They met in homes, always with the good program. And now we've gone back to that because we have a women's group that meets in homes again. So we can get back to the process of knowing each other. And if you notice the pink around the sanctuary today, we are acknowledging that October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And yes, we worship in a church where you can say the word breast. It's okay. Breast. Women have breast. Breast cancer. And so do men. Some men get breast. Actually, I know someone. But you know what I'm talking about. Sexism. But there was a cancer workshop put on a project by the Women's Fellowship in 1971. And there's a whole section on that. There's a leisure club, a church parlor, the bargain box. The women got together and opened a gift shop on Oakland Park Boulevard, provided $41,000 of funds to help the church in operating it on special projects. $41,000. Well, $41,000 went to the mortgage principal. $7,000 went to a deficit note. Church operating budget, $3,600. Community action board, $6,000. Church world mission, $6,600. No, it was $65,000 in 1979. Today, that'd be about $800,000. So the history of this church is rich. And to God be the glory in every man. To God be the glory. Next week we'll be talking about present day. We're going to talk about the last couple of pastors here, two or three pastors after these pastors have left, and how that God is working through the church today in the present time. To God be the glory. In the second reading, we hear from Timothy, and warn them before God that they are to avoid wrangling over words, which does no good, but only ruins those who are listening. Is that what the church does today? Is that what we do today, humanity? Out in the world, do we wrangle over words, which does no good, but only ruins those who are listening, with all the division on theology and who to love and how to love, wrangling over words. Timothy is sharing with us to do our best to present ourselves to God as one approved by God, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth. So just maybe what we learned over the 65 years, with all the ups and the downs, and 5 years ago we were sitting with 50 to 80 people in worship, and now, you know, you can see that fire that's smoldered. God has stoked the fire, and the flames are coming back even brighter than they were before through the work of the Holy Spirit. But maybe what we need to learn over the 65 years isn't what happened, but how we responded. Maybe Timothy's sharing with us today to avoid wrangling over words, to wrangle over love. Have we learned? I've noticed in the last 4.5 years, sure, we've gone through, anytime you have change and transition, you do have conflict that arises. You can't avoid it. Things change. When a church grows, things change. They're not the same. But what I have noticed is an avoidance over wrangling over words. And not dysfunction, but function. What we're seeing is Timothy's vision come alive and his call from God. At the conference, a youth minister from Coral Gables took a group of youth to Taizé, France last year. They're known for their music, Taizé music, it's like chanting. You tuneful, very healing, meditative type of music. So they traveled to Taizé, France, and he's their youth leader minister. They go to the Taizé service in the church, and oh my goodness, there were 2,000 to 3,000 people there, he said. The music started at 7 o'clock and 7:30. It was wonderful. They had instrumental, they had choirs, and they had all these people leading this music, these chants, the chants of praying, of meditation, of being one with God, and nothing but that focus at that time. So the service lasted, and about after an hour, the people who played the music got their instruments, and they started to leave. And spend an hour. The choir starts to leave. The ushers start to leave, and a lot of participants. But out of the 2,000 to 3,000 people, 50 people stay. 50 people stay. They were singing. Singing their prayers to God. 2 hours, 3 hours. This core group, they wouldn't leave. They did everything but flick the lights like a bar does at the end of the night for people to leave. Not that I would know. They wouldn't leave. He takes the children, the youth, up to their place where they were staying, and he puts them to bed. It's 11 o'clock, and he says, you know, we have a rule. You have to be in bed and asleep by 11. Puts them to bed. He goes back downstairs. He looks, and in this sanctuary, this huge church, there's still 50 people in the pews singing and chanting and praying and meditating to God. And I sat down with them. He said it felt like when a fire, a campfire, goes and it starts to die out, and the embers were there, and God comes along and God stokes the fire, and the flames start to erupt. And the Holy Spirit and the wind of the Holy Spirit fuels and fuels the fire and becomes alive. And he said, I could feel it. The faithful. May we pray that the Holy Spirit fuels, stokes our fire. You feel it in the room. One of the things people say when they come here, they hear it so often about, feel the Holy Spirit in this place. I know I do. I feel it all around us and through each one of you. So we pray as we continue through our anniversary, God continue to fuel us, to stoke our fires, to help us to keep our eyes and ears and hands and feet open to your word in Jesus' way. I think Paul shares with us the answer. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 14, 4 through 7, in weddings, and I say this passage in weddings, most weddings, people ask for it. But maybe it's how we're truly supposed to live. How we love. Love is patient. Love is kind. It doesn't envy. It doesn't boast. It's not proud. It doesn't dishonor others, and it's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongdoing. Love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with the truth. Love always protects us, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. So as we go into year 66, let's be reminded from Paul how to love one another. I think when we do, we'll see that fire grow even stronger.
Long Bye. Thank you, Anthony, for that inspiring music. Let's go to God in prayer. Dear Lord, we are so fortunate that this church has been here for 65 years. Just the smallest piece of time in this world's history. But 65 years where this church, standing on this street, on these corners, has been a witness to the world around us. But Lord, we cannot stand on any of the past as we stand here today in the present, and as this congregation moves into the future. Let us take the lessons we may have learned. Let us claim the strength that you have offered to us, and the guidance and the prophetic nature of your message, and carry that with strength and determination into the future. Lord, we call upon you to be with many of our friends and family today as we call out their names, people that we love and that we care about, who are in need of special consideration and care and healing. Please call out those names at this time.
You hear the word. You have breast cancer. They're frightening words. And as Werner Herb wrote, live as if your life depended on it. Every day is a gift, even the challenging days. In that moment when you hear those words, your life is changed forever. They challenge us to seek the most up-to-date, tested treatments available, and experts who can deliver these specific treatments. For us, achieving the outcome of I am cancer-free. There are challenges with living with breast cancer. Psychosocial, while not a medical concern, psychosocial can be the emotional impact of stress related to family and friends interaction, daily living, finances, employment, and more. There are physical, which could be treatments, whether related to side effects, change in weight, gain or loss, pain, scar disfiguration, and or fatigue. There's mental, which can come in the form of anxiety, depression, or isolation. And these may occur as a reality of having breast cancer sinks in. As Ryan Hammer said, cancer doesn't end when treatment ends. By sharing your experiences with others and or being a mentor allows others the ability to navigate their own journey, knowing they are not alone and are supported. The person living with breast cancer then feels unparalleled compassion and love with no fear, no longer the fear at the forefront of each thought of dying. The healing process then progresses in a smoother and calmer manner and allows us to go beyond ourselves and reach out to those in need. Men, women, and young adults get breast cancer. 1 in 8 women will develop invasive breast cancer during her lifetime. For Caribbean women, it's 1 in 3. For a man, 1 in 1,000 will be diagnosed. However, men, you do not report a breast lump until it is larger, more advanced, and perhaps untreatable. Everyone is at risk. Making lifestyle changes will lower your risk. Changes such as increasing physical activity. Sarge is considering yoga. That ought to draw a laugh. Limiting or less alcohol consumption. Maintaining a healthy weight will lower your chances. Miracles are for everyone. We have the capacity to make the decision and conscious choice of treatment to rid our bodies of this disease. It takes courage, strength, love, and deep faith to do so. But we can and do complete this struggle, giving us a better life, new outlooks, and forever friendships forged through our journey. The color pink represents our journey and is our anchor. It says we are strong, bold, brave, fighters, and beautiful. We never give up. We also can help achieve the impossible for our church by attending, volunteering, and other things we could do. We come to worship and be with God, expecting to find strength and peace to live our lives as He would want, We need to go beyond ourselves for God and ourselves and others. Hope, faith, and love sees the invisible, feels the intangible, and achieves the impossible. And finally, the pickle lady wants to say, "Hey, cancer, nice try. But after 11 years, I'm still here."
Thank you. Thank you.
remember that in our, in this world, not our world, this world, our hands are
God's hands.
Our feet are
God's feet.
Our words are
God's words.
Let us go in peace to serve and love the Lord.